Go for it.
I think most of you have seen me. I have been a feature around the University of Wyoming for 25 years. And I have loved UW in every component I've been part of. I used to work in the College of Agriculture back from 2000 to 2006 before I became the Associate Director of Admissions. And then I was there for 8 years, and I ended up back at the UW Foundation office raising money for the College of Agriculture for the last 4 years. I took a little break from UW. I wanted to see if there was anything better out in the world, and I realized, how can you get better than working at the University of Wyoming in the College of Agriculture when you're making an impact? That really everything you do makes a difference for Wyoming. So when Dean Rasko called me and asked if I'd be interested in helping start this program, I'm like, well, tell me more. And it's amazing to me as I'm learning more about it and how they're trying to stand it up right, of the thought process they're putting into it. So before I go into more detail of the program, I would love to know a little bit more about you guys, because you're obviously here for a reason or have interest. So why don't we start with the introductions? Tell me if you went to the University of Wyoming or if you have a degree in any of this component at all, and then why you're interested in learning more, just so that I can help address those questions.
So Shelby and Zach, I'm the new extension specialist at UW. Don't have any degrees from Wyoming, Fresno State, and then master's and PhD from New Mexico State. But it's all in BCAL, reproductive physiology. But I'm just interested to see what you guys are doing and where I can help or where you can combine things. So.
I love that.
McKenna Britton, UW Extension Educator in Young County. I was born and raised in Wyoming and attended the university for my undergrad in Nebraska. And I'm kind of like you, there's nothing better than the folks.
What year did you graduate?
Fall of 16.
Okay, I was just wondering in what capacity I was there, why you were there. So you do look familiar to me. So
I was all around the inside. And,
okay.
All of that.
That's
probably why. I have Avery Gales. I'm currently a graduate, but I'm also a graduate student at UW in the animal science department. My undergraduate is from the ecosystem science management department at UW, so folks through and through. I have a history of ag leadership, so I'm really interested in the ag leadership program.
Good. I'll probably even pick your brain more.
My name is Brian Hamilton. I'm a local producer. I attended UW for a couple of years, but I was just thought it sounded interesting to see what you guys might be talking about. And I was looking for ways to help with maybe internships or something like that. We have a local ranch over by Lander.
Okay, great. I'm so glad you joined us today. And all of you guys, I'll be picking your brain and following up. Right now, what I love that Dean Rasko is doing with her administration team, so she's working with Kelly Crane, who is the Associate Dean and Director of Extension, and then Rory Means, who is the Associate Dean and Director of Academic Programs. Right now, Sarah's area of internships and scholarship coordinator falls under Rory. But the big component of the success of this program, we really feel lies into the internships and kind of the applied learning pieces. I changed the word to apply.
I like it.
So that's something that we see and we're hearing over and over again. I was at Wyoming Stock Growers when we announced this in December. And just so you know, my contract fully got funded or started in January 11th. But we decided that the momentum was right and that Stock Growers would be a good time to announce this up and coming program. So it was with Farm Credit Services. They gifted $1.5 million to fund it. And legislation really supports this concept and this need for Wyoming that they matched at $1.5 million. So we have $3 million to kick this off. And because UW sees the importance of it, they did go through a central position management request, and the executive director role has been approved to be hired. It's really tricky to start a new program in the midst of budget cuts. So that was the first question I asked. It's like, oh gosh, I would love to help, but is this the time? And it is, because the private money is there to help support it, and it's our hope to figure out ways to make it self-sustaining. We are working hand in hand with the foundation to look at bigger gifts and take advantage of match money. $50,000 or more can be matched, which can help continue to support this program. But what I love is that Dean Rascal is like, I want to do it right. I want to make sure that we set this up successful, because Montana State actually stood up a ranch management program, and they use their current coursework, which is great. And we have a lot of good current coursework and departments, which many of you are familiar with, that can be add-ons, that can easily come together, figure out what's best, what we think's the best. But sometimes, and you might think this way, is academics gets in our way. We are not known, and I can say this from being out in the state as long as I have, UW itself sometimes is not known as being nimble. Or to the point of too academic and not applied. And I think that's where the College of Ag has always been a little different. I think we try to make sure that we have hands-on opportunities and options to help people continue to learn. So then using that as our springboard to make sure we're successful. So instead of taking our current coursework, and if you guys are really interested, I do have a draft that I can send you of coursework that we have that's right on the table that we could stand up a bachelor's program. But we're thinking, what do we need to do to really create a program that is a coveted program that people of the West will enjoy, and that's something like, King's Ranch, at their institute. But in Texas, it's a little tricky because they're more private lands. So we're looking at ways to how do we help our students and Wyoming be successful in learning opportunities when you're working with government and federal agencies as well as private public land. It's a big checkerboard. Wyoming's a huge checkerboard. So how do we set them up for success? How do we look at our current coursework? And how do we also make sure they are getting what they need? So again, this is where Dean Rascal and Kelly Crane and Maureen Means are like, well, let's ask before we just make the decision in academics, seeing what we have, stand it up. Let's ask and see what the core competencies are out there in the state. So we're doing listening sessions. I'm doing lots of phone calls. A lot of people saw the article or press release, and they have taken it upon themselves to call me and tell me what we're missing. And you can imagine there's a lot. And a lot of it is not just in agriculture. It is that leadership component of hiring and firing and managing people. Those underlying soft skills that are so important to running really any business, but especially a ranch. And then also the accounting side, the business management side that can be overwhelming, and how to figure that out. Let alone, you guys have to be experts in tax law, water law, like pick all these different areas, oil, gas areas. Even hiring people from different countries to come in, and what does that look like? So there's a lot out there that we're trying to figure out what are the core competencies and how do we build upon that to build a successful program. So instead of taking our current coursework we had, we're taking a step back and we're asking. And I'm really proud of the UW College of Agriculture because they're not just asking, but they're listening. And this is the first time I've seen this approach to building a program. So my job today now is to listen more to you guys and hear what you're thinking and feeling, or where you see needs of this area of either being a generational rancher or going to be a general manager to a ranch in the West. So we talked about leadership. I'm curious if you'd like to start there and what you're thinking, like, ooh, I wish, I hope you guys do it this way.
Yeah, I might need a second to think about
that. That's fine.
I think you talked about soft skills, like just the people management skills of ranch work and ranch life, and I think that's one of the best things to be a part of that program. And I think that's where maybe a lot of internships would come in, and I learned most of my people management skills through internships and through grad school.
So tell me more about the internships you're involved in that really helped you.
Yeah, so I've worked for Justin Turner on the HPU DRS station for the last 4 years. And the first year I was kind of the baby, and like grad students took care of me, but moving on up, I was the only one that returned.
I basically became their boss and helping navigate people that had never been on a ranch or people that were from Texas and moved up to Wyoming to work on the ranch where there was a lot of differences in ways to do things. Texas has their own way of doing things and Wyoming doesn't always like it.
We are our own state for sure.
Yeah. So just the people management, how to talk to people, how to lead them through different tasks. I think that would be a major point.
I love that. And I think that we're hearing that over and over again. What are some other things you think of? Like, what are things you think of? You're like, ooh, if they're going to do it right, I hope they have this.
No, I really hadn't put any thought into this at all, I guess. As far as working producer, it's the same problem that I think everybody's having is finding not even qualified help, just willing help, I guess, is our hardest thing. I don't really look for ranch workers anymore. I just look for willing workers because seems like there's a lot of people that come out of college that ready to be a ranch manager, but don't know that they really know how to do anything but manage, you know. Everybody wants that $100,000 ranch management job, and we're needing, I guess, a way to find value in some of those ranch positions that could help be able to pay the ranch help what they're worth.
Right. You know, the ones that do work and show up. And what does your turnover look like at your ranch for work, for help?
We're really lucky, but the last person we had, he was for 9 years, and then he decided he needed to find something better for his family, and he went back to school. And the guy I have now, he's starting on his third year with us, and you know, we'll see how long everything's going fine, but you know, it's hard to be able to pay somebody that works on the ranch a wage that they can raise a family and have you know, the kind of quality of life that you want somebody that's worth, you know, keeping around to have. And that the guy I have that is working for us now, he's single, he's in his 30s, but we found a real happy medium because he's a real outdoorsman. He's always, and I found that giving somebody, maybe I don't pay him all that much, but I give him as much time off as I possibly can to scratch his itch, and then, but then he knows when I need him, and he's there and ready and available and everything. And one of the ways we kind of get around not being able to pay a salary is having a house for him to live in and that kind of stuff. But yeah, it'd be nice. There's, you know, a lot of real skills that come along with ranch work, that if there's people that have, and it's more of the technical type skills, the welding and the equipment running and mechanicking and stuff like that. But if you have a ranch hand that has those kind of skills, you can't pay them the kind of wages that they get for being a professional welder or a tradesman or something like that. But those are the kind of people you need. But it's a hard way to. It's something we struggle with, but I think it's the. No matter what you struggle with, or small business or any business, trying to keep motivated, willing employees.
I think we see that everywhere, and that's across the whole nation, unfortunately. I don't know if we'll ever be able to fix that piece, but I think learning how to manage within that turnover, I think will be something important to have on the agenda of many agendas.
And that's the last two employees that we've had, they knew nothing about agriculture or, but I mean, I didn't.
But they work.
But they work and they're willing and they.
Yeah.
They want to learn and sometimes, you know, we always joke about it, but it's the truth. Sometimes molding fresh clay rather than trying to knock off the hard edges of a rock or, you know, somebody's. A lot of people want to show up and tell you, oh, well, you should do it this way, or this is how we used to do it. And it's like, sometimes if somebody just show me how to do it, that's really nice. So we really have had good luck getting just green, willing young guys to go to work that have the right attitude. And that. And being in Lander, there's some good opportunities with Knowles and some of the outdoor recreation activities. You know, the last guy we have, he was a firefighter for the service or for the Forest Service in the summer and then made snow for his ski resort in the wintertime. But he loved climbing in Lander and he wanted a way to stay in Lander. And I was like, man, you ought to be able to calve if he can make snow, and you ought to be able to work in the heat if he can fight fires. And we've had a great relationship so far.
One thing that comes up is generational ranching and figuring out the transition piece, like how to turn over the helm. How do you get the senior to want to let go and let the younger generation make decisions where they don't understand the decision making or what their information they're using, and how to navigate that? And talking about soft skills is how do you facilitate discussions? Do you always hire someone, or are you trained to at least have a general thought process to help with that kind of that piece of the puzzle? Because it's tricky, in addition to finding hard work now. But what do you guys think as we're talking about this program, if you're like, ooh, Pepper, I know a lot of people in this area and they should have.
I think there seems to be a big need for like the hands-on portion. But
yeah.
I know like in the animal science department, we really try to do that. So I mean, I teach the beef production course and
yeah.
You try to get them out there as much as you can, but you want to make, it's kind of hard when you're, here's 2 hours, well, I can't teach you how to AI in 2 hours. So I think if you could set up something where they're getting more hands-on stuff, but also not just hearing from one person. And I think the internships, that's great.
Right.
I think they need to be able to go out and hear from producers who have been doing it. Maybe a variety of them. That way, because everybody does things differently.
Oh, for sure. Every ranch.
My dad
does
stuff totally differently in a ranch in California than I learned in New Mexico. And things are different here than what I'm used to when I was in New Mexico for 6 years. So I think getting them a variety of training from different people, there's so much that ranchers can offer,
right,
as far as experience. And so kind of matching them with somebody that you.
We are hoping that, looking at the experience, and this is one thing I've challenged Sarah with, because she's the brains of the unit, is how do we provide the type of experience where it doesn't mean that they're going to be an expert in the industry in that area, but they have data points to pull from, or be like, ooh, I saw this go wrong one time, let me call someone, or ooh, I saw this situation with water rights that you need, we should maybe get a lawyer. Those kind of red flags. Thought process, and we're trying to figure out how to develop that in a real opportunity where they're like working with federal and government agencies, because knowing how to not manipulate, but be part of the conversation, to be at the table and to understand what they're talking about or converse with them on the needs you have is really valuable and important. And so how do you do that? Well, being immersed at least a little bit, if not like a 2 week rotation, with these different organizations could be really beneficial. But then how do you do that during a school year and still graduate in a 4-year capacity? So we have a lot to kind of figure out there. But I should back up and say that it is the hope to have a bachelor's program, a master's program, and a certificate program. And one thing we're hearing over and over again is the need for continuing education, even if you're in the industry. Like, you want to know the newest and greatest out there, and then the cost break point, like, is this something I should be looking at? Will this help me enough that I should invest in drones to do X, Y, and Z, to monitor my fields, in different ways, to go check cattle, to take family pictures, no, I'm just joking, but, you know, those kind of things. It's like, how do we provide continuing learning opportunities working with Extension and their expertise already so that we're real focused? And now with budget cuts, we also have to think about the University of Wyoming working with community colleges, Extension across the state, and how do we, like, if they go out into the field and they're doing an internship, maybe it is during the school year, because you can only get so much experience in the summer. So maybe it is during the school year, and then maybe they take their classes from the community college in that area, or they go to the Extension office and they can log on, and we have Zoom capability. That's probably the one thing that's been beneficial from COVID, is that people I never thought would Zoom, including myself, now Zoom on a regular basis. And it's not so scary, because we all had to learn. It was kind of a necessity for us to keep doing business. So how do we continue to utilize that technology to allow people to meet people where they're at, getting the hands-on experience day or in the morning or night? So what do you think?
Well, I agree with Shelby a lot. My one caveat probably is taking all of the classes that Shelby's not even teaching. Yeah, you can go to the beef unit and you learn how to brand or whatever, and it's usually a disaster because there's kids that have never done it.
Right.
They might be from Colorado or wherever. Regardless, at the end of the day, that's not what you learn, in my opinion. And I was lucky enough, I did an internship with the Hoodoo.
Oh, great!
And then
With JD. Yep.
And he's a ranch management guy. And then I was a little ballsy, but I went and did an internship down the border of Arizona in Nogales. And learned tons.
Because it's so different, right?
And probably half of it doesn't apply to Wyoming, but it opens your eyes
to different opportunities.
Well, I got two recommendations. First, I think you should look at Nebraska's feedlot management program.
Okay.
We have about 20 kids every summer that do it. And they play, it's hard because they've got feedlots close to Lincoln, so they all come in and take classes before, during, and after. But it's set up right. They all get placed in a feedlot, and they even have kind of some little research trials and
stuff.
We can
do that when we go to Farm Credit.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty good. And they're set up with feedlots, they get paid. I mean, they get paid.
Did you go through that program, or?
I didn't. It was going on while I was doing my master's there, but. I think it's Galen Erickson. He's one of the nutritionists there. The other thing, probably turn back more to your, how do you wear the hat of law to accounting to, I mean, at the end of the day, yeah, you're running cows, but that's a small portion of your job. And you can take, even if you go to the University of Wyoming, you can take a class from Chris Bastian or written or something, and you can learn a little bit about it, but if you walk out of there at the end of the semester, just hope you pass. Or I took ag law there, and I remember very small.
Is that Justina?
Yep.
Okay.
But I think even if you, same thing with trying to get in like H2As and getting people in for out of country or whatever, if you almost set it up more like the seminar classes at Animal Science, I don't remember who, I think Rule taught it the year I was there, and to me it's not a worthwhile class. We'll maybe get that later. But if you even set it up that way where it's semester long, but every 2 weeks is a new topic, so you spend 2 weeks just on simple accounting.
Yep, and we did talk about that. That's great.
That way you could do it during the school year, and then during the summer they're actually learning how to set staples. Really, at the end of the day, a lot of these kids, if you're going to college instead of going to a trade, they don't know how to weld, or they don't know this or that, but that is the things you need.
Right.
Those need to be set up with the internships. I mean, most of the kids are probably going to hate it the week that they have to learn how to weld or something, but there's going to be a kid that loves it, and they're still going to use it.
Right.
So a question for you on the internship front. How do you feel about, like, micro-internships? So maybe doing, like, one full semester internship, like making that a requirement potentially, and then having a few micro-internships that are kind of patched together to
even, like,
to fill that requirement.
Yeah, we're trying to find the 5 core competencies that we should kind of have as part of that.
I think that's great. I mean, even when I was at the to do. I spent the first month calving. And then after that, I was basically up on the mountain keeping heifers up high or bulls up high, then heifers down low, and then ended with AIing for the last month. So in a way, it was almost like that. It was a month here, a month there, and a month there. I don't think that was intentional. It was just cheap labor for them. And I was willing to AI, so. But I think that's great. And if you, I mean, even if they're working with you and you said, okay, at this place, we're going to learn about these three things, and you've got 3 weeks to do it. I mean, it helps your producers out, and it helps your kids learn. I think the other big thing is, I mean, Wyoming's very diverse. From Wheatland to Cody is, I mean, 40 different states in between. So it's even sending kids more like here, Wheatland or Powell, where you actually grow something. And they learn a little bit about that. They might actually get
You mean you can't grow something in Laramie?
Yeah, no. Maybe sagebrush.
We have 90 frost previews.
Yeah. Yeah. Or I can send them to Rock Springs and they're learning about government leases and having cattle on the range. I mean, it's, you learn a million different things just across the state of Wyoming depending on who you're with. So.
And try and figure out what those tracks look like and then having the students self-identify the areas of interest and then stay focused in each track, having the rotations is something that we're kind of toying with right now. Again, I'm just proud of UW and the College of Ag for taking a step back and saying, let's do it right. We get to do it once, and we have this huge support, and continued support is coming in, so we definitely are listening. And I think we're on track. I think what you all are saying is really consistent with what we're hearing, so that makes me feel a little better.
I think our students are thinking, but I think there's even some opportunities with the classes that are offered currently.
Oh, for sure.
So, like, I know you guys touched on them a little bit, but even maybe restructuring some of the ones that currently exist. So, Scott Miller's range capstone class, we laugh and call it the NEPA class because that's all we did in the NEPA, or in that class, was just talk about NEPA over and over and over again. But maybe that's an opportunity to restructure it for the benefit of that degree program itself, but also for your program, and do the couple weeks where you work with the Forest Service or you go to BLM and have like all the different agencies touched within that capstone class.
And I think that is something that is absolutely doable with that specific class because we had talked about that and then COVID hit. So we were working, we was working on restructuring parts of it to be more beneficial for you guys.
And I think that would.
So that's doable.
I know a lot about NEPA, but I could know more about other
things. One thing that,
you know more about it?
Yeah.
Oh, geez. One thing that Kelly Crane said that really resonates with me and I think is going to be essential to this whole program is having the leadership component or the soft skills built in every course. Like, what does that look like to help you grow your skill set? Because just taking a class is great. You learn about that specific area, but having it where you have to present or identify or come through a different lens. Maybe you have to do your paper through the lens of BLM or Forest Service or a big ranch, like Hoodoo, compared to a generational ranch that is very different. You know, it's different when somebody else is paying the bills and you're on these big ranches versus when you're the one that's paying the bills and how does that look and how does that feel? And then with the ongoing educational piece, that's something I'm really interested in is how we build that up and work it out so that we have, maybe there's a subscription to monthly presentations that will benefit you that you can have access to. And if you come to campus, they can be via Zoom too, but if you come to campus, we have networking going on. So maybe you run into a student, you're like, I like you, do you have an internship? Let's go figure this out. Because I think you mesh with what we're trying to accomplish and the questions you ask will help us gain this project, this special project we're trying to identify on our ranch to make it different. So making sure we're really including all of Wyoming and beyond to be part of this bigger process is important to me. And I think that'll help us gain more legislative support if we are really building that together with those courses or networking or workshops where that we're kind of combining and maybe we have information on BLM that the whole Wyoming could benefit from, not just the that's something that we're trying to figure out. How do you build that out in these different layers and keep that successful? So, and then the leadership thing as a whole, there is so much leadership opportunity out there. One area is Farm Credit Services has a leadership program within it. There is Agriculture and Appraisers of Tomorrow. They have a wonderful leadership objective. Knowles is one that, you know, we hear and think of how can we pair with these different areas. And maybe if leadership is really the area that you want to go into, you do your internship at one of those sites or one of those areas where it's real in-depth and a different level, kind of tapping into what's already out there. In addition to our coursework that we do have on campus, it's just sprinkled all over. And I don't think, even when you're in one program, you sometimes don't know what's offered in another college. So knowing that we offer leadership courses within agriculture, we offer through college business, through the Hobbs School, and how to build that out. So
I know National Cattlemen's League, so NCBA,
yeah,
they have a pretty good like young cattlemen's kind of leadership program. I know quite a few of the state cattlemen's association kind of follow that, where they let those producers or students who's ever involved go like follow the lobbyists at the in Washington D.C.
Right.
Or the state capitol. And to me, that's a huge deal. Being from California, it's a huge deal knowing
right.
what laws are coming in and how that's going to impact you and all these.
Right.
Different propositions and everything, so I think that could, not that they need to learn how to lobby, but learn
how to see how things are handled at that level and
how to address concerns,
right? Advocate for
and
themselves.
Maybe it would help them, even for somebody who wants to be a ranch manager, that you need to get involved with these organizations to help policy.
So I was on the phone with the Deputy Department of Ag, Stacia Berry. She was really involved in FFA and 4-H and went through the College of Ag when I was there. And she's like, people need to have availability to policies and understanding them. And so it's, I love that you touched on that, because I think that figuring that piece out, because we are gonna have that. The one thing I am cautious about, and I don't know if this is told true with Kelly Worry or Dean Rasko, but we can't be it all. So how do we identify, gosh, I'm thinking like four areas, and then they can track out in there, and how do we identify that to be careful so we do it well? Because when you start to get too many options, nothing is well maintained. And so I just want to be, that's my biggest caution there. So figuring that out. But we're going to keep vetting this. We're listening right now, and I love it because we've heard a lot of things you've said, and then how to take that back and apply. Sarah, what do you think? What would you like to add that we're trying? Because you've been part of the at the table for almost all the discussions. Did I miss an area of that we're trying to identify or a thought process?
No. I think you actually did a really great job of kind of the bullet points that we were talking about,
that's
the main things that we are wanting to kind of conquer with this program of sorts. I just want to encourage each of you guys to reach out to us. I realize that this is being recorded and we kind of put you on the spot here, but your feedback, your input on this is so important. And like Pepper said, it aligns with a lot of the thought processes that we have and that we've heard from across the state already. And so you guys are going to help us make this as successful as possible. You guys play a huge role in that.
Mm-hmm.
And we really appreciate your feedback on this and your thought process. Don't hesitate to reach out, once you ruminate on this a little bit, be like, oh, I forgot to mention this. Shoot me an email, shoot me a text, call us. I think, it's going to go a long ways. So.
If we do this right, and we really combine our resources working with Extension, the community colleges, and bringing in experts all over the world that can elevate all the ranches, and make Wyoming stronger, that's when I feel like I'll sleep at night, like we were successful in what we're doing. So I really think that it's kind of also taking what's already out there and reformatting it and remarketing it and having that opportunity for everyone in a different format that also aligns with educational goals. you guys to death. It's 12:36, but I'm here until you're done.
I guess the only other thing I have to add is, you know, get the question, why do you like ranching all the time? And one of the main things that I appreciate about it is the change from all around the entire year, and that's where I keep thinking about your how you incorporate into a school year, because it really does take a year for somebody to be around, for it to click, to be like, oh, that's why we did that 3 months ago, is so that we're ready for today.
Right.
And you know, that's the thing. Whenever I'm about sick and tired of haying, well, it's time to start rounding up cows. And about the time it's you don't want to see any more cows, well, it's time to start doing something else. You know, then there's calving season. You're ready to be done calving. You know, everything, something's always new and different to do around the corner. But it does take that year of experience for somebody that is completely new to it, for the light to come on, to be like, and you know, I try hard to let them know why we're doing what we're doing as we go along. But it's, you know, when you're throwing them a lot of information, it's not retaining sometimes that, oh, this is, you know, but it once after a full year, then things start to click and they can realize how to make their life easier too, as far as what they've done over it. Because to me, it's 365 days a year trying to make the next 365 days a year better and a little easier, and learning from what we did the year before.
So one thing throughout my life, now that I'm on the older side, I think of everyone in this room, is when I started at the College of Agriculture, just in the dean's office, just as a secretary, I realized then, and this applies to ranching or anything, the first year, you're just trying to figure out what you're trying to do, right? So when you bring an intern on, it's like, ooh, drinking from the fire hose. The second year, you try to remember what you did. And then your third year, you're like, okay, I can make this my own now. I've seen, I remembered, and now I don't like the outcome of this, and I'm gonna tweak it. And it does take time. So making sure we build out a real thoughtful program so these people have enough data points to pull from, knowing they can't be experts in everything, or you guys are gonna be there for like 12 years. And how to build upon that. I'll tell you guys this, and people laugh at me, but I see this, it's not well received, but I feel like this is a little bit like 4-H programs. Because you know how they have to, in 4-H you have record books, you have to have a historian, you have to, am I right? Like how you're going through this, how you're learning, and how you're learning real hands-on, because you want to make it fun for kids. I see this as a glorified level. It's like, how do we make it that way where they're learning their accounting, they're doing their books, doing the historian piece, and also being that applied and trying to take it through that lens as we address each of the classes. So we have the current courses, but what is needed to maybe bring them up, elevate them, the ones that are really necessary outside of the statistics, you know, your normal university studies program requirements, but then how do you elevate that to that next level of learning within each class just a little, where it's different than just that main course, but you have the soft skills, you have everything you need in that one course that you're really learning, and then bringing that home. We had a really great interview with Tyler Gardner.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I need to email him today. He went to the King Ranch Institute, and how he went from taking a finance class, just a normal finance class, but then in his, let's say, capstone class that will be part of this program, he would go and apply that on a project at a ranch. His recommendation is going to make a difference for that rancher. And I think that's where, when you feel a little bit more pressure, like whatever I recommend, they may do, and this could be make or break them. I mean, it makes it feel more real and making sure that's there. Another idea I have, and I don't know how we will manage it or what that'll look like, but is possibly utilizing this cohort on the bachelor's program. Is that junior year class, they would start a research project for the state of Wyoming on one topic. So let's say we have 40 kids in the class, their junior year. All 40 kids, they could either do it in groups or individual, because life is tricky, and be all in on the research project. But maybe they're not doing the research, but they're finding out research that's already been done and making sure we're all aware of it, because I think that can really make a difference. Thank you. Thank you. And so then they would do that for 2 years, their junior through their senior year, and that would be their presentation. Or maybe they come through it with, through different lenses on that research project, like how would BLM handle this? How would Forest Service, NRCS, how would a big ranch, how would a small ranch? Let's just take cheatgrass for one, because that's a common one. That's a good topic to pick. Or how they would utilize drones. Something, and it could be anything, but it would be something that would make Wyoming better. And I think that would be kind of interesting to see if we'd have any breakthroughs, because somebody's all in, like it's all focused on that area. So every junior class would have a different project. So we'll see. We'll keep you posted. You guys can rate us after we get this program started. You can let Sarah know. Is there anything else you want to add before you leave? I loved your last comments.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, no problem.
I'd be more than happy to chat with you about internships.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.